So it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Medina Rick from Mogadishu University, and he will be speaking about quantum mechanics and quantum field theory also.
Yes.
In a space with a finite number of points.
Yes.
It's 40 minutes, 5 for questions.
Okay, thank you very much. First of all, I'd like the organizers for inviting me here. And of course, it gives me great happiness to talk in this event in honor of Natik. It's been quite a while. Well, I was last time here something like 20 years ago, more precisely 18 years ago. And this occasion, I was very happy to come here, enjoy the nice atmosphere of mathematics and mathematical physics, and also the weather, you see. Right now it's 7 degrees in Istanbul and it's been raining for 24 hours. So I don't know what has happened to the weather, so I feel especially happy to be here. Okay, when I did this work about this quantum mechanics and quantum field theory, of course, one thing that's basic that I should remind you is that if you have finite number of points in a space, that means that your position space is in Hilbert space is finite dimensional. It's just the number of points. That means that you're doing quantum mechanics in a finite dimensional Hilbert space. Okay? So everything is nicely expressed in terms of matrices, and any operator will have then the same number of eigenvalues. They may be degenerate or whatever, and there is no continuous spectrum for any operator. Okay, so that's an important thing. So after we did this work, I was thinking, well, what about an oscillator, you know, with finite number of points? And then I looked at internet, searched for it, and I came across here a paper here. This is actually, I think, a series of papers, right? In 2001, and all the old friends are there. And I was very sorry that I'm not one of the authors, okay? But I will not talk about this. I will actually talk about our own work. This work, I don't think, can be considered original, because throughout the years, physicists have thought about this. But with this work, I started thinking about it. Well, the point is that, is quantum mechanics trying to tell us that the space has a finite number of points? Okay? Now, the reason for that is, let us take some very old example like the hydrogen atom, okay? And the hydrogen atom has a number of excited states, but we only use, in practice, the first few excited states. So the infinite number of states doesn't matter. The same with the harmonic oscillator. When we use the harmonic oscillator, we just use a few states. So it really doesn't make any difference whether the Hilbert space is infinite dimensional or finite dimensional. Okay, and there is always, within the axioms of quantum theory, saying that you should do quantum theory in a Hilbert space and you should do it in a separable Hilbert space. And what is a separable Hilbert space? For a naive physicist like me, a separable is it's almost finite dimensional. Okay? It is finite dimensional where the finite dimensions goes to infinity. Okay? And the mathematical definition that you see you should have a countable basis is actually the same the same has the same meaning. Now, once one starts doing this, of course, one is led to some difficulties. I will talk about the difficulties, but first I would like to talk about the basics of the start. And this is in a paper with my graduate student, a recent paper with my graduate student. And what it is about is that, maybe I should. Is that if you have a finite number of points, like I said here, okay, then you have an X operator, and the X operator has some finite number of eigenvalues, and we take this number n to go from 0 to d minus 1. So we have d points. But the point about this thing is that X is not well defined. Okay? Now, one can consider two things here. One can consider a space that has n points, or one can consider a space which is periodic. The periodic case has been considered by Schwinger many years ago, and then people have considered the same thing over and over again. Okay? Now let us first consider the periodic case. For the periodic case, of course, X is an angle, so it is defined modulo some number n, d. Okay, so if I have d number of points, if I increase d, I come back to the point. So the thing here is X is not a well-defined operator, but instead of X, one can exponentiate, make a unitary operator V, and then V is well-defined. And the basic thing that V satisfies is V to the power of d is equal to 1. Now, just as one defines from position eigenstates the unitary operator V, one also defines a unitary operator U, actually, which is translations in position space. And as we know, the generator of translations in position space is momentum. But in this case, of course, there is no momentum because this is discrete, but indeed there is a well-defined unitary operator. And then these two unitary operators satisfies VU is equal to Q times E to the UV, where Q is equal to E to the 2 pi over D. Okay, and this is basically the work of Schwinger. Now, in the process of trying to improve my talk, actually, what I did is I lost a page. I realized this morning that I had lost a page. So what is the lost page? I want to talk about this. Now, suppose I have a d number of points. Okay, so we have d number of points in the space. And then associated with these points, of course, I can have vectors, okay? So this is the vector for particle being here, 1 for particle being here, and d minus 1 for the particle being here. And just like we have a unitary operator U satisfying this, in this case, my operator, let me call it A, because it looks more like an oscillator that increases this, and then A star should take this to 0, okay, because that's the end of the Hilbert space. And similarly, I have an operator A, and this is sort of like the ground state of the operator, and A should take it to the number of 0, okay? So I should have an algebra like this, and one can prove that this is all equivalent to a simple algebra A star plus A star to the D minus 1, A to the D minus 1 is equal to 1, and A to the power of D is equal to 0. Okay? So this is the sort of algebra, and of course it is in some sense It's a trivial algebra, and it is the simplest algebra. Okay, so this is the simplest algebra, which has a unique d-dimensional representation. Okay, and you see, as in this case, you can actually derive it from this simple consideration. Then when you do this, of course, it takes some work to prove that this implies a unique representation, which is given by what I have written here.
Is it possible to express these operators A and A dagger in terms of U and V? Have you tried that?
Yes. Of course, that's the next slide.
You have this
expression? Yeah.
Probably. Okay. Then I will...
You see, once... writing A and A star in terms of U and V is more difficult. But what I will do is I will write... Okay, so here is summary of finite dimensional quantum mechanics, actually. Here we have the usual boson operator, which is infinite dimensional. And you see, this is terrible, because you see, the eigenvalues, actually, which are of the number operator, 1, 2, 3, increase, and this matrix is, of course, an unbounded matrix, and it has terrible properties. Like what, for example? You can ask, well, let me define my position operator to be A plus A star, like you do in ordinary quantum mechanics, but make this finite dimensional, cut it off, and look at the eigenvalues of your position operator. They are terrible. They start getting near each other at the endpoints, etc. So this doesn't look nice. This won't do the thing. And here is the Schwinger U. That's on the other page. You see, A here is almost unitary. The only non-unitary thing about A star or A is just going to zero here. Okay. So what I do is I take A, and I add to it an operator, which is actually, again, trivial, so that from here, U will take you to here, okay? So this part of U is the usual annihilation operator. It will go like this. And then when you come here, this is the extraordinary part, which will take you from here to here, okay? And that's the Schwinger U. And you can also write A and A star in terms of... So you can start... write everything in terms of everything else. This is extremely simple. And then one has the relation. So here is our boson case. Here is the standard fermion case. And this thing is in the middle. I gave it the name Mermion. But M is not formatted. M is in Turkish, we say, you know, when we say something, and we want something like it, we just take the first letter off and put M here, OK? Like, for example, you have Obama, Mobama, or something like that. Okay, so here is this algebra. And of course, in this case, I should write down what my Hamiltonian is. Okay, so one can write down Hamiltonian. But in this case, there is something that's funny. If I write the x operator in this case is given by a complicated expression. Okay, so this is the position operator, and you see it's highly nonlinear, and then it doesn't look very pleasant. But you can also write down a Hamiltonian. What is Hamiltonian? The Hamiltonian is, you can write something like A star minus A, the translation part, and then you just square it and minus sign, put a minus sign, and essentially a constant divided by 2m, so you can write the Hamiltonian. Okay, so much about quantum mechanics with a number of finite. Spectrum of the Hamiltonian, Well, of course, this is for the discrete case. It is like it is in the paper. It is like square well, okay, essentially. Instead of n squared, you have sine squared of n, things that go like sine squared of n. And when...
Sinus.
Huh? Sinus? Sine, yes, sinus.
Yep.
Okay, and also for the Schwinger, well, actually for the Schwinger case, there are two candidates for the Hamiltonian. One is you treat it as a free particle, okay? Although there's no momentum, you say it's p squared over n. But that's not nice. I think the nice part is, again, you get something like this, h, but instead of a, you write u, u star. This is all in the paper, okay? Once you write it, the calculation is straightforward, and one can calculate all the eigenvalues and etc. Okay, so this is so much for quantum mechanics. And of course, what one would really be interested is quantum field theory. Now, in quantum field theory, there is a huge body of literature about lattice theories, lattice quantum field theory. Okay, but the idea behind lattice quantum theory is sort of backwards. They say, well, the real space is continuum, okay, and but we cannot do calculations in the continuum, so we just take a finite lattice. But I think the philosophy should rather be in the opposite direction, and that maybe we actually have a finite number of points. Okay, so I'll start with something that will look standard quantization, and we know how the standard quantization goes. It starts from an action, okay, then we define the canonical momenta, okay, then we define the Hamiltonian, and then we have Poisson brackets. Okay, and the Dirac way of quantization is just taking the same thing and replace the Poisson canonical Poisson brackets with quantum brackets. Okay, so once you do this, is uniquely defined. Once you do this, okay. Now it's so important that of course, if I have a single point in my space, then I can have infinite number of particles. Now, it doesn't matter this is a single point. I call it this is a single point. Now, here the formulation, I make a formulation where the time is continuous, but the space is discrete. And then people will immediately ask, what about Lorentz invariance? I have a few things to say about this. Okay? But we start here with this. And then we know what this is, of course. This is just the harmonic oscillator, Lagrangian. Okay, but the interpretation is different. Phi is the field, okay, and what we have usually as the spring constant, it is the mass of the particle. And immediately when we quantize this, I will use units with h bar equals 1, c equals 1. That means that 1 meter is just 3 times and 10 to the 8 seconds, and 1 electron volt is 1 over 200 inverse nanometers. Okay, and phi is the value of the scalar field at a single point. I quantize this, and I immediately get by the canonical formulation that h is equal to this. And here is this problematic vacuum energy. If I have infinite number of points, or if I have a continuum, then that gives me an infinity, which is a renormalization problem of quantum field theory. But here you don't have any renormalization problem, because this will just give you a finite number. And for 1 point, it is just 1/2. Okay, so n is the number of operators. So this simply tells you that You can have zero particle, one particle, two particle, etc. And here, of course, since there is just one kind of particle, there is no interaction. Okay, but it's nice to remember that because actually any number of points is not very much different than this. It is very similar to what we have here. Okay, now even with a single point, one can try other things. For example, if instead of if the potential, the usual potential, you replace where the classical solution is given by A times sine mt, where m is the mass of the particle, okay, in units where h bar and c are 1, one can use a different v of phi, which is actually phi squared plus 1 over phi squared potential, okay, which looks like this. Now it is amazing that one can also quantize this, and the reason one can quantize this is, again, the classical solution looks very much like this. Okay, so this is just a special case where B and C, here B and C are related to this parameter lambda, and if one calculates the Hamiltonian and one finds that this is M times the normal part plus the new part, and you'll recognize that as n goes to infinity, the particles behave as bosons because this part goes to zero, okay? But for small n, this is an additional contribution to energy. So to create these kind of bosons, self-interacting bosons, one needs more energy to make the number 2 or 3 or 4, okay? But the increase in energy, the additional increase in energy for creating these particles is actually gets less and less as n goes to infinity. Okay, now let us go to the case that we have 2 points to make things clear and simple. And for this case, of course, here I have the sort of free particle case for the 2 points. And then we put an interaction between the 2 points, which is just phi 1 minus phi 2 squared over 2a. And of course, this is the kinetic energy term. Now, when one tries to solve a model like this, one finds the same kind of stuff that we heard in the last talk yesterday. One can draw a graph associated with this. Okay, so this is a link between points 1 and 2. And then, just like for graph theory, we have this coincidence matrix. Here we have a Laplacian matrix. And the problem is the same, diagonalizing and finding the eigenvalues. Now, one thing interesting here is that, of course, this parameter A is just, we take as the distance between 2 points. And I would like to call this parameter A the scale size of the universe. Okay? Why do I call it the scale size of the universe? Because I'm also interested in cosmology. You see, in cosmology, according to what we measure, we find that the space-like portion of this curved space-time is almost flat. So if it is almost flat, and if I have finite number of points, I can approximate it to a very good approximation by a lattice, or as I will assert, maybe there are a finite number of points, although there are some problems with that. And then there is a free parameter that's called the scale size of the universe, and that scale size of the universe is not fixed. But here it is the fixed. The scale size of the universe is here for a discrete space has a very fundamental meaning. It is the distance between two nearby points. Okay, and then I can again calculate, well, why did I do it? 2 points, because it's simple. Okay, so anybody can go through the calculations. You can go through the calculations in your mind, even as you're sitting there. Okay, and then when I find the canonical Hamiltonian and its eigenvalues, I find that, you see, there are particles at rest, this is n0, or the particles having some momentum p. Okay? And then in this case, I should have an energy conturbation. So I have, the interpretation is clear, so I have n1 particles with momentum p. Well, actually, momentum is not well defined in this case, discrete case, but I call this, there is still p squared is well defined. I still have this, and then h is equal to this. And then I have a Hilbert space. Hilbert space is R2 times R infinity. This R infinity is, of course, has to do with the infinite number of particles that I can create. So I should have mentioned here that N0 goes from 0 to infinity, and N1 is an integer that goes from 0 to infinity. Now, of course, getting old, now I talk to philosophers more than I used to do when I was young, okay? And a philosopher colleague who actually started as a mathematician at Boğaziçi University, I was talking to him about that. Does it make sense to be able, well, we have bosons, right? What does boson mean? In a state, you can put any number of particles given it. But does it make sense to put infinite number of particles in a given state? Okay? And he said, no, that doesn't make sense. So here is some deficiency of this model I said. This should not be infinity, okay? Just as one has finite number of points in space, in a given state, one shouldn't be able to put infinite number of bosons. There should be a finite number of bosons, but really I'm not able to do that. You could say, well, why don't you use this algebra, which was so successful in this space thing? It is not, because it's highly nonlinear. Okay? So when you try, you see you should change the canonical quantization rule. But if I don't know what the canonical quantization rule in this formalism is by using this. Okay, so that's a deficiency. Okay, then one can also calculate the momentum. This p is the same. This p, it comes out as some constant over a, where c is just can be calculated from the model, of course. Since I know the Lagrangian, I can immediately calculate the Hamiltonian using the standard formalism. Okay, how much I have? 10 minutes or so? 15.
17,
okay. Okay, then of course one can do and generalize this to D points. And this goes exactly like this, but now I have, instead of having one momentum value, I now have D momentum values. Why? Because my space is D-dimensional, and I can calculate these D momentum values and write this out. Okay, so this is just a joke, of course. But one can calculate it. Now, there is always the question, you see, when people, there are lattice gauge theories, only a few have tried to use continuous time. Usually, people say, well, one has Lorentz invariance, and if one has Lorentz invariance, then if you have space discrete and time continuous, you have a discrepancy, okay? But I would like to argue that actually there is no discrepancy. Why there is no discrepancy? Because Minkowski space is too special. It is empty. Okay, once you have empty space, of course, it doesn't make any difference whether you have discrete or continuous or whatever. Okay? And the other thing is that the most important consequences of special relativity is not Lorentz transformation, but the formula relating energy and momentum. Okay, so this is an important, this is, for example, at the Large Hadron Collider, when we fit data, we use this. Okay, but we don't, we never use the actual Lorentz transformation that changes x and t into each other. Although that's important, of course, because that's how special relativity was discovered by Poincaré and Einstein. The Lorentz transformations are important. But what is important is this energy-momentum relation. Of course, this follows from that, from the Lorentz transformations. But it also follows, as I will show, from this formalism. So although there is no mention of Lorentz invariance, it is apparent that one will have Lorentz invariance in energy-momentum space. Now there is the other thing, because in general relativity, there is always a special time. You can always put the metric in this form, and t is, one can call this to be the cosmological time. This is important. Why? Because what we call Minkowski space is actually an approximation for a small portion of the space that we have. And the space that we have is not empty. It's full, and we have cosmology. Okay? Now, it's an assumption of cosmology that, for example, atomic clocks, okay, tick according to this cosmological time. Okay? For cosmology, of course, this part is simple. So one could always use the coordinate invariance of general relativity to put the metric in this form. And then when you do the put the metric in this form, there is nothing wrong in asserting that this t is continuous, but in fact, the space variables are not continuous. Okay? Okay, so having developed the formalism, of course, we tried to solve whatever is solvable using this formalism. And, well, as we did here, it's the same technique. We can solve if space is finite from one end to end, or if space is periodic. Okay, so this is a nice example that I have a cylinder where one dimension is finite, but the other dimension is periodic. And then we can calculate the spectrum for that. And when we calculate the spectrum for that, we immediately find that the energy is this energy of each mode is just square root of m squared plus px squared plus py squared. And we can calculate the px and py. And you see, well, I should maybe have dx here, not d, and I should have dy here, not d. And you see, it is the similar eigenvalue. So it is the important thing that one can have an open space or a closed space. But here is immediately a problem with finite number of points being in space. You see, if I have finite number of points, I could have various possibilities for the space. But the only things that I know how to solve, I have shown, are just finite, in which case, for example, the space would be something like a cube. Okay? It's not a cube in anything, but it's a cube itself. And whenever it is a cube, of course, then the isotropy and the homogeneity are lost. Okay? Well, if you make the number of points very large, you can get homogeneity, but isotropy is lost. And we know that, as far as we know, space is isotropic. For example, one can measure the black body radiation, and the black body radiation, if the space was not isotropic, if it was a finite number of points at lattice sites inside a cube, one would have a large octuple contribution. One doesn't have. Okay? So one needs a theory which in the continuous limit, okay, will not give you an infinite space, but it will give you a finite space. For example, it will give you S3. Okay? So this is the problem. How do you have a finite number of lattice points, okay, such that in the continuum limit it looks like an S3? This is a real problem. And it looks like a very hard mathematical problem. Yes. It looks like a very hard mathematical problem. So this is a main thing, but maybe it will be solved. All of this recent stuff is in a paper, actually to be published, I should say, because it has been, the paper has been blackballed by the media, so it got rejected some number of times. I think it's a very nice paper, but in any case, it hasn't been published yet. Okay, now let me talk about some more interesting things about this cosmological connection, because there is a problem with it. And one can ask, well, how many points are there in space? Well, let us see, what is the largest size that we know? The largest size that we know is of the order of 10 to the minus 30 electron volts. So the inverse, this is 1 over the size of the universe. And it is interesting that the Hubble parameter that we measure by expansion of the universe is related to the size. Okay, so this can't be a coincidence. And usually we believe that the smallest length is related to the Planck scale. So it is 10 to the 30. Here, actually, I'm approximating the exponentials. Instead of 33, I write 30. Instead of 29, I write 30, etc. So the number of points in three-dimensional space, being something like 10 to the power of 180, is consistent with everything. You see, this will perfectly look continuous. Okay, so with today's physics, this is continuous. Well, you may say it's a very large number. It's a very large number, but it makes, in theory, remember the motivation, it was the separable Hilbert space. The separable Hilbert space is actually a finite dimensional space, and it has this many. This is the dimensions of the Hilbert space that one would have to use. Okay, then one can play other games with this thing, and one can say that, well, I had the scalar field here. Of course, one could also generalize this to other kinds of fields. So instead of, in addition to that, I would have a part of the Lagrangian where the scale size can depend on time. Of course, as we know, the space is expanding. Okay, so I could have A depend on time. And then one can ask, well, what is the simplest kind of Lagrangian that you can write for A, provided that A depends on this time, which is the continuous cosmological time variable? And, of course, in physics, well, let's write something with no dimensional parameters. And with no dimensional parameters, one can write this Lagrangian for the A part. And this immediately gives rise to an accelerating universe. Well, does it explain anything? Well, actually, it doesn't explain anything, because getting acceleration is not difficult. But the primordial acceleration rate and the present acceleration rate are very different, so that's difficult. And of course, there is the question that how does general relativity arise from this? Why did I come back to the same thing? Okay, so this is the last slide, actually.
go ahead.
So, if you return to the Schwarzschild boson matrix function.
Which one?
It's a handwritten.
Oh, the handwritten, yes. This one.
Yes. So this matrix, this operator for boson is a non-bound.
This one, yes.
Then you can see a truncation. Truncation is a bounded operator.
That's right.
So why is this is a true such model with finite truncation?
Yeah, actually, we had done such a model many years ago. If you truncate this, then you get an algebra again, which actually defines this. One can do that. One gets an algebra like this. With some factor d or d factor, I don't remember here, some constant depending on d. Okay, one can do that. Okay?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Have you looked at the discrete version of the Fourier transform, which is in continuous case interrelates a coordinate and momentum realizations, right? So there should be some discrete analog.
Discrete? It is, I'm sorry, I forgot to mention it. This Schwinger thing, although Schwinger does not mention it in his paper, it's exactly the same as in mathematics as the discrete Fourier transform. The finite Fourier transform, you mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
No,
the finite Fourier transform.
It's the same. I mean,
it's the same, exactly the same. Yeah, it's exactly, yeah, it's exactly the same.
Okay.
Exactly the same.
No, it's fantastic because we looked recently at the discrete Fourier transform and tried to define explicitly eigenvectors for discrete Fourier transform. And then we constructed Reisner-Lorentz operators for this. And then constructed Hamiltonian. And it turns out that it has the same type of spectrum, although they do not exactly coincide with your Hamiltonian.
I see. I'll look at okay, let's discuss that. Okay.
But unfortunately, those operators, raising and lowering, do not satisfy simple computational relations. They are rather of this type computational relation, which wrote for truncated cases. Okay. So, but yeah, we definitely discussed that.
I should say that I really like this algebra. Of course, this is very nice. It is sort of the mother algebra of all algebras with finite dimensional representation. For example, take the rotation Lie algebra, SU2 Lie algebra, and constrain yourself to some J fixed. Also write that relation, and then you can write that algebra in terms of this, and you can write A and A star in terms of J1, J2, and J3. It's just a nice exercise that my problem solved.
You mentioned that Schwinger never came to this final stage speaking about defining simple computational relations between, as you wrote there.
His relations are simple. He has U to the D is equal to 1. V to the D is equal to 1, okay? And then UV is equal to E to the 2 pi I over D times VU. Okay, so it is, these are actually, they are almost the same, okay? But they are the same because they both have unique D-dimensional representation. Okay, so this is what Schwinger wrote down, because he only considered the periodic case. If he would have considered the non-periodic case, space having a beginning and an end, then he would have obtained that. Okay, and the relation is, of course, as I said, U is equal to just A plus A star to the V minus 1. One can also write the inverse relation, but it's much more complicated.
Thanks, so,
Professor. Okay, thank you.